My name is Monday Ozoya. We started like this Greater Tomorrow that we used to hear in the National Stadium. So that same passion is what has taken me forward. In my career, I've gone into the military. I've retired from the military. Spent some time in Liberia, Senegal. But when I left, I went to England. When I got to England, I went back to study. Even from Nigeria, I went back to studies. And I studied construction and property. So I was doing well in property. But something struck me. We have companies like the Los Mega in Nigeria. So if I'm coming back to Nigeria, what impact am I going to make in the society, my environment? The impact is going to be zero because there's no way I'm going to contribute. So there's no houses not built in Nigeria. So I had to change my career from construction and property to sports. So I had to go through grassroots football from the ABC of football by the road. So currently at least I've had about 3 degrees in when you talk about sports, I have 3 degrees in different degrees in international sports business and management. And by the grace of God, all things being equal, I should be going on my master's degree. Once I go back now, I will decide when to start my PhD in sports. All is agreed to. We need, that's the area we really need people. Just like Dr. Lukoya. So, he's my mentor. So I think he needs support from people like us. But the difference is not being on the field, like you said, it's in the classroom. So, guys, you're welcome. That's just a little about me. My life, all I live for, is not how many houses I want to build. Trust me. Not how many cars I want to drive. Not how many. There's none I can afford. But my passion lies with the community in Nigeria. My heart bleeds each time I look all these grassroots, what they go through. But during my days in Nigeria, you have good time in football. You have field everywhere. That has disappeared. Everybody building house, these big cars and all those. And look at what is happening to youth out there. So we have a big role to play as a group because we have that power. We are the one that can save this country. Trust me. They might not recognize us, but we are the future. If things is going to change in Nigeria, forget it. It's not going to change anything. It's me and you. What we do with those little kids is what the impact on what the future generation of Nigeria is going to be. So basically, information is not long, it's just maybe one slide. I'm going to just summarize the arms of policy for you so that we all understand why we are having some of the challenges we have and why things are not working. We've had two policies since we started playing sport in the whole of Nigeria. The first one was 1989. Under those two policies. One is 89 and one is 98. One is under IDB. For that 10 years that we had that policy, there was nothing that was implemented in Nigeria in your policy. For 10 years, nothing was implemented. So when we say we have crisis in our sport in Nigeria today, we should know where, why we're having those crises so that we can know how to get out of it. Because if you don't know where you're having a problem, you don't know where you're going. So, 1998, we had another policy. That was under Yaragua. And between that time and now, I don't think anything has been implemented in that same policy. But money goes out. In that 1999 policy, what do we have in that policy? We have 15 outcomes that the government wants to achieve. When in the last 10 years we've not implemented any, and now the new policy is telling us we want 15 outcomes that we want to achieve. Those outcomes, one of the outcomes, out of the 15 is instrument of national unity. If we ask ourselves, are we actually using sport for our national unity? The weight is currently at. I don't know, everybody has his own answer. For me, the answer is no. We are not using sport for national unity. The second one is to minimize antisocial behavior. It's actually our sport is minimizing antisocial behavior. In the game, we should be having 1,000 club, but they have to get 1 million points.
1 million points.
Should we be having 1 million points? If actually the policy was meant to deal with antisocial behavior in our community. If you ask them, the answer is no, that policy is not working. Nobody cares about that policy. It was only in the paper. The next one is, the policy says, use sport to generate employment and create wealth. Before they involve in this game for a long time. Nigeria is generating employment. How many youth are employed? Every year, how many youth does NFL say, okay, football coaches or basketball or handball? How many of them say, this year, this is the budget we have. We are going to train 2,000 coaches this year. So we're going to split them into quarters. So we're going to train them. Nobody has ever seen any policy that tells you that, oh, we are training 2,000 coaches this year for basketball, for long tennis, for casting. So that tells you that, yes, we have the policy in paper, but in implementation, it is zero. Then another one is to ensure adequate, proper funding of sports at all levels. Do we really know how much we spend on our sport in this country? We don't have a clue. NFF will come up, basketball will come up, handball will come up. You see them fighting themselves when it's time for election. After that has gone, nobody comes out and tells you, okay, yes, at my time as the president of this sport or this government body for sport, this is what I'm going to do. We're training social coaches. We're having this program, we're having that. This is what is going to cost us. We'll never hear that. So, we should all know where our problem is coming from. So, I only picked that because I felt if only the policy can address just those 5 or 4 key points, outcome, out of their 15, if we can just look at 1, 2, 3, 4, number 5, just that 5. At least we know where we are going and we know where we are coming from. Those are the 2 national policies. In case somebody wants to check them out, you want to read them to know more about the policies. It's in the other, so you can check them on online. There was a study in 2013 by one Mr. Samuel They made those studies. And what happened? They said the study revealed that 61% of sports stakeholders, such as sport administrators and coaches, are not even aware of policy, that the policy exists. That was in 2013. If 61% of stakeholders in sports in Nigeria are not even aware that there's a policy for sports in Nigeria, that tells you that we'll be sleeping. Then, another 39% claim to be aware of the document. Only 26.8% seems to have seen and studied it. So that tells us we have problem. If 61% of stakeholders in sports has not seen or know that we have sport policy, and only 39 said, okay, we are aware, and then only 28.6 has even read it to know what is inside. They ask, tell me what those administrators we have and coaches and everything out there. And I'm quite sure a lot of us have not even seen that policy. So how do we know how we are going to fit into the nation, what the nation wants to do in sport? When we don't even know what is guiding us or what we need to do or how we are going to do it or how we are going to achieve it. If we don't know it, how do we move forward? We the right man to disciple, because what we believe will be something to benefit us, not what will benefit us as a nation or as a people. So that's what we get currently. So let's look at the UK system. The UK policy focus on five. Physical well-being of the people, everybody in UK, not only just those playing the sport. Mental well-being of everybody, not just those playing the sport, of everybody in that country. That's what the policy is focusing on. Individual development. There's nowhere in our policy that says individual must be developed. Whether you are part of this board, you are not part of this board, but the UK policy says individual has to be developed. Whether you are part of sport as a coach, as a volunteer, as whatever you do within sport, you need to be developed to understand their social and community development. It's not only just to play sport. Sport is not used like we just want to play sport, people make money, go abroad and get done. The youth, every child you see playing sport in England must have conduct, must conduct themselves, your behavior in the community. So parents, teachers, the young players, everybody comes together. So they see sport as for social, they see sport for social development and the community development, not just play the round ball, play up their head and hence their love. The policy is saying is for social and community development. And lastly, economic development. Sport is not only just play for fun. Yes, we play sport, yeah, we enjoy sport, but the system put that policy in place to say, not only will we play sport too, but economic development. When you look at Premiership today, you see, even we ourselves, we admire what they are doing every day. Oh, they play, go in Man U, United, and everything. It is because the policy, there's a policy in place. So just as you have the Premiership, you still have the Professional Football Association that still supports the professionals and still support the grassroots. An average academy player now in England, if you join the academy of any of the professional clubs, even if you cannot make the professional team and play, make your career within that, what are they doing? Money that they are making from all these professional leagues and all those stuff, they bring the money in to support those grassroots players, because you've told the grassroots player, oh, you are good enough to join my academy, and they join the academy and it's played till they were 16, 17, 18. And you just throw him out and say, oh, sorry, you can't make our team. So why have you wasted all these years? Giving him that false hope, oh, you're going to be the first team player. So if you just kick him out and do not prepare him for the next challenge of his life, he can become a drug addict, he can become anything out there. So but what have they done in that system? They bring money in, and in every academy, apart from you playing football, you can get your degree through that as well. So if you are not a professional player, you can be a sport therapist, you can be a sport scientist. Also, you can be a coach, you can be a referee, you can be anything you want to be. So if you're not playing in the first team, you still have a career, you still have a role to play with the game. So you are not just thrown on the street, playing in the academy. So that tells you what the system is all about. Between 1995 and today, Britain has only had 7 policies. The first policy was by John Major in 1995. And what did he do? He looked at sport and said, sport is dying in England. We are no longer maintaining our position in the world when they see us. Something needs to be done. But how do we get this done? That is how they came about lottery fund. You know, you hear UK lottery fund and all this lottery fund. They now come, how do we make money? They came up with lottery fund. Money that run sports, to support sports. That's where money comes from. To run sports in UK. So they don't depend on government budget. Then, apart from that, they have money from like professional league, champions league, and all those. They still have money from all those areas to fund that. Also, we should understand that why our system is not happening is because we don't have the right policy that will guide what we do with this game. But they have to be as. If you look at Spain, let's look at Spain. In Spain, participation in sport is your right. If your child don't go and do sports, they will ask question, why is that child not participating in sport? If he doesn't like this sport, he likes this sport. Because it is that child's right to play sport. So, the legislator is in the act of the parliament that sport is your right. So you must do sport. And what do they do? They have about 7 outcomes for their own sports. Sport for society, for social activity. Because when you bring people together, they interact and they relate together. And it brings life, bond, and unity within community. That's why you see two brothers, two friends, they don't fight. Even if they have differences, they will resolve it because they play sport together. So you have this to fight it. The practice of sports as a fundamental component of the education. So, if you are going to film, you must do sports. My Lord, I'm not going to say you can just go there and say, no, I don't want to. You must do it. And if you are not doing it, they will ask questions. Why is your child not participating in sports? So, if you cannot do all this contact sports, you can do the best contact sport like tennis or running, gymnastics. They must be sport for everybody. They use it to foster equality and social solidarity. West and South crisis before they are independent. So they've used sport to bring that solidarity and to bring the different part of the country. So there are, if you still notice, if you hear on the news sometimes, you see them saying Catalan. Where they have Barcelona, you still see them still saying, no, we want to go have our own independence away from Spain. But the way they've built the country, it's difficult for them to go. Even they say we are 14, we are dead, it's difficult because they built sports and different leagues to tie them together. Then they created specifically elite sports. If they identify talent, they develop that talent. When they get to that stage, whereby they see that this child is potentially an elite class athlete, he joins that team who are professionals. So their own job is manage elite sport, and that's where they get funding for that sport. So you can't say, oh, you are very good, and you don't get funding. If you see that, yes, this is a potential athlete and is an elite athlete, you join that group, they just select you as okay. And they start, even if you are 5 years old, they start funding you and preparing you for the next Olympics. Maybe when you are 16, you are 17, you are 18 or 20. You understand? They put you on that path. You get funding and you want to study. So that tells you that sport is not something that just happens by the way. It's the government will, the people's will. It has a role to play in the heart of the people. But we don't see that, we don't see like, it's a hobby, you can always come and say, no. The time to make that decision, whether it's your sport for business, it's your sport for charity, or you want to earn a living from sport, the time to make that decision is now. You are getting older, you are not getting younger. So when you retire, and you think of you to coach football for 20 years, how do you look after yourself at pension when you've not even completed any pension? So the time to change and make that decision of what your sport means to me. Is now. It's when they put a regulation framework that guides whatever they do. Each, like state, local government, federal government in Spain, the autonomous county and all those things, they do checks and balance.
Why not?
To make sure who is doing his own role, who is not doing his own role. So they It's still changed what is going on. And that's why you find out that today, when you see sport is failed, everybody plays sport. At least if you cannot play football, you can go to gym and do exercise in the body to defeat. So it affects your health. So you spend less going to hospital. Because if you know they're growing fat, they're there and big body, they get bad health. You end up in hospital when you're obese. So, you go to gym, it's free. The government makes provision for everything. So that's basically about Spain. Spain, they had 1, 2, 3, 4, about 3 policies. That's what Spain has had since 1975. We've only had 2, none have been implemented. We've had 3 after their revolution and after the hosting of Barcelona 82. That has been the most successful Olympics, whereby they spend money to develop their country. That's when they put, because of their hosting Olympics, they put all the express road you see in Spain that they enjoy today. That 1982 is because they are hosting Olympics. The whole world is money. That is when they lay the landmark for Spain. And you see everybody is traveling today and going away. It's because of sports. They spend that money. They borrow money, quite all right, to build their own, build the facilities. But at the end of the day, what happened? They made money. They made billions of money. So it's only Spain, Los Angeles, 1994. 82, 94. Those are the main successful Olympics since they started the Olympics. Every other Olympics that every country has hosted before they entered it, which some of them are still playing to be carrying to finish this. Because it was politically motivated, not because it was really sport. Look at, if you look at the UK chart, their structure. If you look at their chart, you can see how they link. What they've done in the UK is, they've got the government who creates the policy. They've got the Department for Education and the Department for Media and Culture. So they have 2 ministries who implement the policy. So education and sport and culture work together. So they look, they have like check and balances. Then apart from that, if you look below it, they had Sport England and Sport UK. Sport England is, they look after anything grassroots. Everybody who wants to play sport, want to go to the gym, want to do anything. They have Sport England to look after that. Then an elite sport, most of them is in preparing for athletes, for Olympics, going to World Cup and all those things. They fall under that. That's where their funding comes from. So they know who is, and they manage the funding in that country. So they know who is funding, where the money is coming from, and they know where the money is going. And every year, they assess each of the governing bodies. Like they've gone to Olympics, they've gone to World Cup, they ask, how many medals do you win in your sport? Like we have our basketball, we have our swimming, we have, they will ask you, we funded you how many billion this year? How many gold did you win in the last 4 years? What did, how many gold did you win? If you can't deliver, what did they do? They slash down on you. So they don't continue to waste money because you are not delivering. They will look at those sports that are delivering or that need, that have the potential to deliver in the next Olympics, and they put the money there. But when you look at our own country, nobody gives account for anything. Whenever they go, like go to Olympics, go to 100 athletes, and all of them fail and come back, nobody cares whether they pass or fail. But forgetting it is the taxpayers' money that they are squandering. So nobody cares. If you look at the Spanish structure as well, it's so simple and straightforward. Like they have like the state, the federal, the local government, they all work and they divide the responsibility, checks and balance for each and everyone. And they have the private, if you are a private sport person, they provide the law, the structure, make provision for them, their role within the sport in that country. their premiership, that Spanish league that we say, government fund the premiership. All their stadium, Barcelona, Real Madrid, and all those people, government put funding to make sure they maintain those stadiums to that standard. Because it's the pride of each of those cities. So they get enough funding from the government. And it is the law that backs that up. Not that we just have to do that. But you open to our Nigeria, that was something I looked at the policy and the way the policy said they want to work, implement and put it. So I came up with that little analysis or chart or figure for you to see. You see that everything runs parallel. Federal government is doing their own. Every year, the federal government, through the National Sport Commission and the Ministry of Sport, this is what the ministry will tell you we are spending. They will fund sport. When you go to state, state will do their own budget for sport as well. When you go to local government will do their own budget for sport as well. But at the end of the day, two people can be the judge. In grassroots sports, do you see any funding coming to grassroots sports? If you look at that structure, there's no link between what the federal government is doing, what the state is doing, and what the local government is doing. All they do is, if there's any time for sports, like they need athletes for Olympics, they've not spent any, they've not given any coach here one naira to support them from the beginning of the year, since they started coaching, volunteering to coach. They've not come to you and say, somebody will say, ah, you get a good player. Oh, you get a good sprinter. They'll say, bring them. Even some of the coaches from some of the teams have learned about coaches. You still carry your own hard earned money to go and lobby national coaches. Say, ah, I get this good athlete. Don't come and give him a trial. When the reverse is the case, they are supposed to provide the funds for you people to work with those kids and develop them more. But rather, the reverse is the case. You as a coach, you are the one now struggling to get your athletes because you feel it's good. And it should be an elite sport athlete. You understand? You are the one looking for money to go and bribe the national coaches. So that please just give this child an opportunity. When that opportunity is supposed to be a door that is open, they should be able to just walk in. And the kids, everyone will be looking for that. If I'm good, I know I don't need to know somebody to represent my country. But today, if you don't have money, you can't represent them. So that tells you that there is a lot of challenges. So I think in the course of my discussion, some of these things about comparison, because of the time I've talked about it, some of the comparison, the way they fund each of the sports like Spain, in the UK and in Nigeria. So at least I've done a bit of comparison, which I think everybody is aware that there's a big difference. The way we see sport, the way we fund sport, the way we manage sport, and the structure of our sport, we find out that we have no structure. We have policy, nobody cares. Only 28.9%, let's say about 29, let's just 9% that has seen our policy and read our policy. So that tells you that we have a problem. So let's look at grassroots football. Grassroots football is anything that has to do with football, apart from those that are said that we say professional. You understand? When we say grassroots football, it's anything that has to do with football. Even if you carry two kids, make them play one v one, they pass to each other on this betting pitch, is grassroots football. That is how UEFA defined grassroots football. And what if you want children football? How do they play children football? Yes. Schools and youth football, amateur football for disabled, football for veterans, and working football. So anything that has to do with football, as long as it's not professional, they're not paid for it, is grassroots. If you attain certain age, it becomes like amateur, but you are not being paid. But if you ask me, Today in Nigeria, we don't have professional football. Forget that name, we say professional league. How can you tell me we run a professional league? A child has struggled all his life. I want to play football. And he now managed to say he's finding himself in the Nigerian professional league. But that child is supposed to find solace in that club to say, ah, thank God, at least all my efforts has paid off. At least I have a future now. I beg to differ. How can you tell me a player who is playing in the professional league in Nigeria does not have a home to stay? And he's playing professionally. He doesn't have his whole house. I'm saying, okay, this is my own house where I can put my wife and kids and pay my rent. He's squatting or he's in the club where a small camp where the club is giving to him to just carry his boots. He has no nothing and he's playing professional. As if that's not enough, you play league for your club for almost the whole season and they tell you we pay how many thousand sign-up fee that is signed to transfer him to that club? He will finish the whole season. They've not even paid the sign-up fee for that player. Even his salary, you finish the whole league, you now have to be crying in the front of the governor's office to say they've not paid us our salary. And we all clap our hands and say, we run a professional football. But if you sitting down here and you are coaching a young child whose ambition is to play football in his life, and you have to tell him that story of him playing through grassroots, struggle with his mother, putting money in and out, when he's supposed to eat food, because the child just said, I want to play football, and he gets signed on in a professional league, Nigeria professional league, and he has to stay for 1 year. Salary has not been paid and he's playing every day. So what happens to his physical health? What happens to him psychologically? What happens to him emotionally? Who deals with his needs? How do you want him to give you his best on the pitch? When already he's thinking about my mother never chop. My children have not eaten. I've not even paid my rent. So how do you think you want to stay and watch a football, a good football, when a player has all those baggages going with him into the pitch to go and play? Definitely, you find out that the industry is in crisis. And one of the ways I think can start addressing the issue is we want to start having few people coming up like me to sensitize young coaches or people who love the game, who are thinking of making a change when we come up and we talk about it. I think that's the good for. But if all of us keep quiet and just say, nothing concerns me, I bet you will still be here another 20 years, but nothing concerns me with the talk. So it's something that all of us has to come together and say, yeah, they might not think about us, they might not support us, but as a group, when we come together as a group, what differences can we make? So we'll be looking at that when we go to the workshop session. So look at some of those challenges now, look at what are those things we can do immediately in the current state to find ourselves so that we can all enjoy the game. At least put small cover for our pockets. If you look at FIFA, you see, when you look at FIFA pumping money and putting slogans everywhere, FIFA is not stupid. When you see them protecting, when they say, I'm not giving a job money, oh, they're moving from from NFL, moving from CAP, and you see FIFA will say, no, he's a member of our association, though. You can't just, as a country, you can't deal with him like that. FIFA is not stupid. Why are they not stupid? Because if you obstruct football in any country, you've only obstructed the future of FIFA. If there's no grassroots in countries, if people are not developing grassroots football in their country, I bet you another 10 years will not be playing World Cup because we don't have players coming forward. When the old ones are going out, we will not have players going forward. Anybody agree with me? If we stop, if every coach stop coaching at the grassroots, in the next 10, 15 years, can we have super youth that makes all of us happy? Who are going to be the players? And what will the level of our football be if all of us down goes and say, okay, we say we're not going to do again? We want to have more crisis in our country. And that's why you find that that topic, the role of grassroots coaches in national media, is very important for all of us. I know some people might not really see that work. Your role, my role, each of those days we talk to those kids, we take them to the field. If you know what you are doing, you'll value yourself more. If you work in your community, raise your head up and work shoulder like a doctor. Because what you people are doing, even your counselor, what they're doing. You understand what I'm saying? If every coach sitting down here today sees himself as a failure, you are not a failure. Raise your shoulder high. Be proud to be called a coach because the coach has evolved all over the world. Coaches are the ones that are making communities survive. Whether in England, in the US, in China, anywhere you go around the world, the role the coaches play is why you see those patients flourishing. You might not need the support, but across every sport, the role coaches are playing. Why some of those countries are flourishing. Sport is not only to say play football and make money. It also tells us what kind of community we are developing. If you look at, I put this organizational structure in that, why did I put it there? That's what guide FIFA has given to countries. To say, okay, as a member nation, this structure will help your football to develop. You understand? What do we do? We've removed that page from our own dictionary in Nigeria. We don't have this structure in place. Why do they deliberately do that? Because if we have that structure in place, we must put funding behind it. We employ the right people to run them. But they deliberately remove that part. So I just put that as a guide. So when you have that manual, you can look at it and digest it and understand why you are strong. So here, if you look at this structure as well, grassroots football department. Now I've narrowed it down. Let's look at the grassroots football department. This is applicable to every other sport. All the governing bodies, international governing bodies, has a standard that every country must follow as long as you are there. But I'm only just going to use football to just break it down for explain. So if you look, we've got three different systems of developing grassroots. But we've chosen what it is. If I ask who is the director for in your local government, who is in charge of grassroots football development? I'm quite sure nobody knows his local government, the person in charge of sport development in his local government. Or does anybody have an idea who is local government, the person in charge of the sport in local in his local government? Ambassador, you Sami, the person in charge of your sport development for local government. Sport is put under agreement. So that is how we've relegated sport. So sports should not be seen or heard, but there's always fun going into that sport every year.